umbrella word is dementia. And in the organizational chart, I guess dementia is the president. And then under dementia, there are different types of ailments that come under dementia, and Alzheimer's is one of those?
Alzheimer's is one of those, the largest one. Approximately 70% of dementia patients have Alzheimer's. There's other factor, other things such as Lewy body and others, but Alzheimer's is the largest component of the dementia world.
Now, could you, for our viewers who, we hear a lot of words that hear about the word dementia, hear about Alzheimer's, could either one of you guys give a brief explanation as to what those two terms mean?
Well, Mark, you could probably go in a little more specifically, but dementia is the the overall umbrella, as you said, of the cognitive impairment. Alzheimer's is a specific disease, has specific things with your brain, the tiles and the plaques building in the brain, breaking off the nerve cells. But also there's other types of dementia, Lewy body being one of them, and frontal lobe being another, that have other distinct factors involved with those. However, people come in and everybody thinks dementia is just loss of memory. There's so many other things involved with this. So as the disease gets more and more known, as we get more and more people into clinical trials, more and more people taking away the stigma of dementia and Alzheimer's, I think we'll be able to more rapidly understand what's going on.
Before going on there today, you may have heard me mention to Mark that a mutual friend of ours passed away yesterday. And he had a form of dementia, and I believe it was frontal lobe. But the most astounding thing to my wife and I, we've seen people that have had Alzheimer's, and it's gone on for years, and until maybe the last year of their life, they've led a pretty normal life. But this person, 2 years ago, was going out to social events. We would go to dinner together, to concerts. And they passed away because of this, and the decline was so astounding.
And that's one of the things that's unique about Alzheimer's disease is some people, it could be 3 to 20 years, you know, the decline being slow. Other people's, the decline can be very rapid. So it changes with different people, obviously, like any other disease. But the key to it now is that we have to bring it back, understand it earlier. What's always been happening with Alzheimer's and dementia, it's understood too late in the disease, therefore not being able to really take an aggressive diagnosis or aggressive campaign to slow it down.
Now this one I'll throw out to either one of you. Mark and I were talking the other night. We happened to do a radio show together, and I was telling him about another friend who developed Alzheimer's prior to my friend who died yesterday of age 62. And he, unless you really knew, you wouldn't realize he had it. And I guess a lot of that has to do with research developments and new medication, which is postponing the advancing of the disease?
Well, also, what we say in our office is when you've met somebody with Alzheimer's disease, that's what you've met, a person with Alzheimer's disease. We get calls in our office, okay, my mother, my father, husband, wife, brother has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. So what's going to happen after a month? What's going to happen after 2 months? Can't tell you that. Every case is different. We could tell you when they hit the different stages what will happen, but every case is different. So as you said, there is medication that can help slow down the progression, but also you just don't know from one person to the next.
Well, it just astounds me having two people in your life, and one is much older, and I'm going to see them at an event this weekend that they're working on. And as I said, they got it before this person, only 60. I'm sort of in shock.
And I think that's the biggest misconception they have. It's an old person's disease. New statistics shows how many people are under the age of 65, and the earliest being diagnosed now is 27 years old.
Wow.
So everybody that's probably watching this television show is in that age category. Mark and I were in Washington recently, and we were talking to a lady whose husband was 36, diagnosed 36. The repercussions, not only of the diagnosis of that person, but how the effect it had on their family for that generations and generations to come are astounding. Obviously, the wife can no longer work. Therefore, it becomes an economic problem for the family. The children are caregivers also. A 250,000 people in the United States are kids caregiving for their families. What happens then? The college opportunities are less, the finances are less. These have effects years and years down the road. which is somewhat unlike other diseases, where whether it's a cancer or something, we can treat the patient, and they're more viable in many respects. Where Alzheimer's disease, it encompasses so many people, so many families, so many caregivers. So it's a unique disease in that respect. No diagnosis or no cure has been found. If you do get Alzheimer's disease, it's a slow, steady death. And that's the tragic part of it.
And when you began the program asking to define dementia or Alzheimer's disease, those really are just words. Obviously, Alzheimer's disease is a situation that destroys the parts of your brain that deal with memory and reasoning and things that you and I do in everyday life, but it's real people, the type of people that David's talking about. Those are just words. We're helping real people.
Now, the Alzheimer's Association of Northeastern New York, you guys, as well as the association in Syracuse and Buffalo, offer resources to families that are going through this very tough time. Either one of you who wants to take it, what sort of services do you offer to these families?
Well, the Alzheimer's Association nationally, there's 75 chapters. In New York State, we have 7, including Central New York, which is out of Syracuse, and Western New York, which is out of Buffalo. We offer five core services, which are Medic Alert Safe Return, which is the type of thing where there's a bracelet being offered to people, so if they wander, 60% of Alzheimer's patients wander, and obviously like anything else, the longer they go, the less chance a good outcome can come about. We also have care consultations, which are one-on-one talks with the families or a complete family or one person to show, as Mark said before, what might be happening, giving them some realistic advice. We also have support groups, which are like many disease support groups. It could be early stage, which we have a viable early stage in our area, and I'm sure the other chapters have that. People that may be in their 50s, just got diagnosed, and they can sit with a caregiver and themselves to learn and talk to each other. So those are a couple other things, and we have education programs. One of the great things about the Alzheimer's Association, one of the big things, is we can educate both community organizations and professional organizations on what this disease is, what's new in it, what people can expect, what are the 10 warning signs, what's normal aging. I'm sure, Joe, you and I have lost our where the car is in the parking lot at Cross Gates or so. That doesn't necessarily mean it's Alzheimer's, but mm-hmm. those are things that people worry about when they get older. So these are the things the Alzheimer's Association of both Northeastern New York, Central New York, and Western New York pick up on every day.
Now, I know you guys aren't doctors, Dr. Kaplan. I was kidding him the other night having the radio show. But are there certain things like vitamin? I know someone who died of Alzheimer's in the beginning was getting shots of vitamin B12. Just as a regular thing in our diet, is it good? And again, I know you're not physicians, so I don't want to put you on the spot. I'm asking the question, knowing these gentlemen are not physicians, is it good to take vitamin B12 or to consume certain foods?
Well, like anything else, a healthy diet is the best thing. You bring up vitamin B and vitamin B12. I think you saw the recent study that was published, I think, last week.
No, I didn't.
Okay, but vitamin B being a possible benefit to be taking, both a complete B complex. Once again, that was a small study, and as you know, many of these things are small studies. They have to go further and further into to understanding that. But vitamin B is really one of the things they're addressing on a very quick basis, because there has been a small study to say that may help.
Also, we got talking last week about diet. And also, there was a meeting I went to that Alzheimer's participated in a couple of years ago, and it was stressed that eating your vegetables is a great preventative for Alzheimer's. You want to talk about diet a little more specifically?
The Alzheimer's Association has a program called Maintain Your Brain. And what that program does, and we want to make it very clear, it does not guarantee you will not get Alzheimer's disease.
Right.
But it is believed among researchers that a heart-healthy diet and a heart-healthy lifestyle will help you a lot in possibly reducing the severity, possibly staving it off somewhat. So dark green leafy vegetables, blueberries, lots of antioxidants, low-fat diet, exercise. That's basically the trick. Again, no guarantee, but that helps.